Well, ladies and gentlemen, I'm honored and deeply grateful and thoroughly intimidated that so many of you have turned out tonight to watch the spectacle of me trying to say something significant about time in just 30 minutes. But I will say, though, that if I don't hold the formal part of this presentation to exactly 30 minutes, that's a challenge for a professor. I won't be much longer than 30 minutes, because the format of this series is conversations and not monologues. And my three questions about time tonight is to be provocative, to stimulate you to thought and discussions, and vehement disagreement is just fine. And also, this presentation reflects my wish to talk not about time as it really is, whatever it is, perhaps I should say what the hell ever it is, but rather to talk about time as we've experienced it, some aspects of how we've experienced it culturally and historically. And I promise you all that whatever the talk itself lacks, the cookies will make up for. So stay for the discussion and stay for the cookies. So without further ado, if I can operate this, let us proceed to the first question about time. Ladies and gentlemen, over the years at UNB, I have learned much from my wonderful and much admired colleagues in the Department of History. And one thing I have learned from my colleagues in the Department of History is that historians as a clan are very leery about attributing too much influence in history to technology and technological change per se, right? I mean, they ask the quite reasonable question, if one adopts the interpretive stance that technology drives everything else in history, then what is it that drives technological change, right? They are very skeptical of the position which is sometimes called technological determinism. But in spite of that, it seems to me that a very powerful case can be made for the fact that our conceptions of time today, virtually everything that we think about time today in science and in daily life, has been powerfully determined by one pivotal invention in history, and that is the coming of the weight-driven mechanical clock of the High Middle Ages. And now, fortunately, it is very difficult for people in this crowded room to escape, so therefore I will tell you that I'm going to proceed to talk about the history of clocks. Don't you wish you'd stayed home and watched the hockey game? We would like to know, ladies and gentlemen, just where and how the weight-driven and by whom the weight-driven mechanical clock of the Middle Ages was invented. But unfortunately, the sources don't tell us that. What the sources do tell us is that by 1400, the mechanical clock had become omnipresent in European culture in a way that it was not in 1300. Clock took many forms. It took the form of tower clocks, town hall clocks, of church clocks and towers that would boom out the hours across medieval cities. And it took the smaller form of wall clocks in workshops and in private houses. In saying this, I don't want to suggest that clock technology was entirely new in the 14th century. There had been other timekeeping technologies, including hourglasses and sundials and, of course, the most important water clocks. All these long predated it. But it was the weight-driven clock of the Middle Ages that first made timekeeping easy and accurate and omnipresent, and some historians would claim culturally transformative. Ladies and gentlemen, I've talked a little bit about the history of the clock, and now it's going to get worse because I'm going to say a few words about the technology of the medieval clock. Weight-driven clocks work, as I guess you can imagine, by the fact that there is a weight which descends, it pulls a rope and a pulley, and the pulley turns axles and wheels which turn the clockwork. And the clockwork, of course, is that series of gears and axles and so forth which turn the hands and ring the bells and sound the alarms, sound the hours, and make a clock a clock. What's the problem with a weight-driven clock? The problem with a weight-driven clock, of course, is that as the weight descends, it tries to accelerate, and that will never do for a clock. You know, you want to find a way in the clock to make the weight descend at a constant rate. There has to be some way to check the descent of the clock of the weight as it falls. You want to put it in modern terms, we want the weight to release its latent potential energy at a constant rate. And how to do that, ladies and gentlemen, was called the problem of the escapement. The problem of the escapement. And the problem of the escapement in the mechanical clock was first solved and solved brilliantly by some unknown European mechanic, probably between the years 1280 and 1300, but we just don't know for sure. And the device which solved the problem was this device, the verge and folio escapement. The verge and folio escapement. Folks, this device works. It's really easy to see and understand if you see one of these things actually working. I wish I'd brought my little replica clock so you could look at it. It would all be easy. But since I didn't, I'll have to say just a few words about it. In the original medieval mechanical clock was suspended a T-bar. This T-bar with the vertical arm called the folio horizontal arm called the folio and the vertical arm called the verge. And in the original model of the clock, the verge and folio was suspended on a wire or a string from the top of the clock so that it could rotate slightly, oscillate slightly like that, right? The verge, the vertical bar, had two teeth called pallets set at 90 degree angles at the top and the bottom here. And those teeth were set so that they would engage the teeth of this crown wheel. The two pallets were set so that they would engage the teeth of this crown wheel. Here it's called an escape wheel at the top and the bottom of the wheel. What you cannot see, unfortunately, in this diagram is the fact that the axle on which the escape wheel turns is connected to the pulley and the weight which tries to descend and make the escape wheel, make the crown wheel turn. Ladies and gentlemen, surely by now you can see what's happening. Well, these people can't see the slide, can't. As the weight tries to descend and make the crown wheel turn, unfortunately, the teeth of the pallet engage the pallet engages the teeth of the crown wheel at the top, so that in order for the weight to pull the crown wheel around, the escape wheel around, it has to push the pallet, and that means it has to swing the verge and folio just a little bit out of the way. And when it does, instantly the pallet at the bottom re-engages at the bottom, going in the opposite direction, so that the motion of the crown wheel is checked at every second, right? So that the weight, which is driving the rotation of the crown wheel, cannot accelerate, right? The motion is checked by the alternate engagement and disengagement of the pallets on the verge at every second. The speed at which this happens can also be set by adjusting these weights, which are found on the folio, the horizontal arm of the T-bar, so that when you look into a medieval clock that's working, what you see is the weight descending very slowly, and you see the folio swinging back and forth, back and forth, back and forth, as at every second the descent of the weight is checked and its tendency to accelerate is stopped. When you watch it, you see the oscillation back and forth, and you also hear the alternating click, click, click of the pallets as they engage the teeth of the crown wheel at the top and the bottom. And that, ladies and gentlemen, is how the mechanical clock came to be, and it is also the story of how the clock got its tick that you always wanted to know, didn't you? I want to make a few comments about this device. Over the next seven centuries, many other clock escapements would be developed, better escapements than the verge and folio escapement, but all of them down to the present still show a distinct family resemblance to the verge and folio escapement of the Middle Ages. In the 17th century, Huygens would adopt the pendulum to the mechanical clock escapement to make the escapement even more nearly synchronous. And as I have told half a generation of engineering students in class after class, in the history of mechanical engineering, everything goes back to the mechanical clock. For the next six centuries, the building and the perfection of mechanical clocks was going to be an ongoing source of transformative innovation in engineering, for the next six centuries. And I want to offer an aesthetic, this is dumb, but I want to offer an aesthetic observation about this little device. If you can imagine how it works, if you've ever had a chance to see one, this is a beautiful, elegant little invention, one of the most elegant mechanical inventions of all time, I would say. And I'd make the observation that our modern educations, whether they be literary educations or whether they be scientific mathematical educations, do not really equip us to perceive and understand beauty of this kind, of this mechanical nature. And now, to be even sillier, at the risk of being sort of rhapsodic, I would say that it is as if, with this little device, time sort of came down from the heavens to earth and revealed itself in machinery. And it's been revealing itself in machinery ever since. But we're not really concerned with the cultural and historical, we are concerned with the cultural and historical influence of the clock, and not with its technology or its aesthetics, you'll be happy to know. And therefore, I proceed to talk about some of the very big claims that historians have made for the influence of the mechanical clock. It is often said that the coming of the mechanical clock eroded our association of time, whatever time is, eroded our association of time with biological and organic sequences, right? The seasons, the harvest, the motions of the sun and the moon, the coming of light and darkness, these are things that happen in time and are measured in time, but after the coming of the clock, they no longer defined time for us. The coming of clock time triggered a transition to an altogether different kind of time, an independent world of objective time, right? It set the stage for that modern sort of scientific concept of mathematical time, objective time, flowing, the kind of time that Isaac Newton three centuries later, would call equitably flowing duration. Don't you love that? Somebody asks you what time is, you know, it's not a problem. Just tell them it's equitably flowing duration. Now you know, right? The modern people subject themselves to the tyranny of clock time in a way that is absolutely unique in history. The whole structure of the modern world, of bureaucratic and factory systems, of the modern order of life depend just absolutely on all our willingness, our mutual agreement, to subordinate ourselves to this abstract mechanical time. And ladies and gentlemen, we may have paid a price for that. Mechanical time may well have pressed on us a new sense of duty and anxiety, right? The need to be on time becomes the inescapable reality of that inexorable external reality, which is mathematical time, mechanical time. You know, it's interesting that time consciousness and religious precepts have always been closely linked with one another in the Western world. Just 150 years after the coming of the weight-driven mechanical clock, the watch was invented. And with the coming of the watch, time changed again, I think, because time then stopped being social and became individual, private time. You carry your time around with you, and you pull it out, and you look at it, and it reminds you of the flow of time. I read that in the Reformation period, some people carried around memento mori watches. Hope I have the Latin right. You know what a memento mori watch is? It's a watch that has a death's head embossed on the dial. And you pull it out, and you look at it, and you see the hands going across the face of that skull. And the purpose of that clock, obviously, is to remind the carrier that death is on the way, that time is flowing, and that it is crucial to take advantage of every moment of that time as it ticks by. And you can tell what it is from your watch. And ladies and gentlemen, I'm very happy to announce that at some point later in history, the Memento Mori watch was replaced by the Mickey Mouse watch, which seems to me a clear evidence that there really is historical progress. It's a sort of debated philosophical position. Believe it or not, historians make even grander claims for the coming of the clock. They suggest that the clock and clock time drastically altered our conception of nature in the universe. Time, of course, had always been associated with the motions of the heavenly bodies. And sure enough, almost immediately after the coming of the mechanical clock, clocks began to be used to mimic the motions of the sun and the moon and the planets. And this is quite interesting. They were maybe even used to mimic the motions of the heavenly bodies more than they were used to actually mark the hours. There's something of a controversy about that, or there used to be a controversy about it. Anyone who has been to Europe and seen a surviving medieval town hall clock in a medieval city knows that it not only rings the bells and marks the hours, but sometimes functions, it primarily functions as what we would call a planetarium. its wheels and its dials, you know, demonstrate the motion of the sun and the moon and the planets. So what, you may ask? In 1382, which was approximately 80 years after the invention of the escapement that I talked about, Bishop Nicholas of Orem first, I think he was first, I read that he was the first, expressed the metaphor of the universe as being a vast mechanical clock. And Orem writes, and get this right, Orem talks about how the universe has been created and set running by God so that, quote, all the wheels move as harmoniously as possible, unquote. And in the words of the historian Lynn White Jr., I love this phrase, this was a metaphor that became a metaphysic. It starts as a metaphor and it becomes a metaphysic. Because we all know that in the 17th and early 18th centuries, the centuries of the scientific revolution, Newton and Descartes, and to a lesser extent Galileo, would formulate the idea of the solar system as being almost literally a mechanical clock, a mechanism thoroughly predictable, running with mathematical regularity under the influence of mechanical law. And if you want, ladies and gentlemen, you can even push this idea even further. The notion of nature as machine sort of dominates the scientific revolution of the 17th century. And some people, including me, would even argue that it dominates modern scientific thought as well. We try to understand nature as a machine. Our concept of what a machine is has grown more sophisticated over the centuries. And this notion of nature as machine is surely a product of the prior European experience with machines and clocks and the mechanical representations of the universe they made possible. You know, what's being suggested here is that Europeans came to see the world in the image of the machines that they had created and see time as defined by the motion of those machines. And to some extent, and I think you can make the argument, you know, we're still doing that today, the clock and time. Well, let us stop this exercise in historical determinism. It makes me feel a little guilty to do it. And throw out the question, are there any other ways in which time and new timekeeping technologies have shifted our understanding, our subjective sense of time, in the way that the mechanical clock did? You read a lot that it's the clock and not the steam engine, which is the defining invention of the modern industrial age. But now we read we're in a post-industrial age. Does that mean that we're somehow escaping, dare I say, the tyranny of time? Is time and clock time becoming a less effective tool for organizing social action? Let me not beat around the bush. At the first discussion in this series, somebody made the comment during the discussion period, which I thought a lot about. It was that nobody under 30 wears a watch anymore. Is that true? Yes. Incredible. And what I want to know, what I've been thinking about ever since that night, is whether that matters. You know, does that say something about the fact that our sense of time is changing? Because time, in a way, then isn't quite as private as it was before. Time becomes associated with the way we communicate, you know, with other people. Maybe it's important, maybe it's not. But I throw it out for the discussion. You tell me what you think. You're a very patient audience, I must say. You up to another question about time? All right, let's go for it. Question number two, how have we come to terms with deep time? Today, school children learn that the universe is 13.7 billion years old, that the Earth is 4.5 billion years old, that the first life on Earth goes back 3.8 billion years, and that the modern humans first appeared on this Earth about 200,000 years ago. And we take these numbers for granted, don't we? We learn them in school, we read them in encyclopedias. But we should remember that these huge numbers about time were not always taken for granted. As little as 200 years ago, which history goes wasn't really all that long ago, no one in European society imagined that the Earth or life or humankind had any appreciable age at all. Now, sometimes this fact is attributed to the prevalence of traditional Christian cosmology, which is interesting in its own right, Time has a beginning, time has an end. There's a finite amount of it and not a great deal of it, perhaps. But the larger point that I would make is that the estimates for the short history of the Earth that were made in the late 18th and early 19th centuries were made not just by people who were concerned with Christian cosmology and knew about Bishop Usher and all that, but were made by people who were atheists and deists as well, right? Who were not at all concerned with biblical chronology. I give you, ladies and gentlemen, the Comte de Buffon, who was the second most famous naturalist of the 18th century, and a thinker widely regarded as a Christian apostate in the century. That's why his book sold so well, I suppose. Who in 1778 made one of the most widely read and quoted estimates of the age of the Earth. It was based on experimental data. And the age of the Earth, according to Buffon, was 75,000 years. Shocking to his contemporaries because it was so long. Shocking to us because it is so short. And if you're not convinced by Buffon, I give you the young Charles Darwin aboard the Beagle in 1831, who says that at that time he regarded 5,000 to 10,000 years as being, quote unquote, I'm not going to get the quotation right, a substantial portion, I think he says, of the total geological history of the Earth. In short, at the beginning of the 19th century, and perhaps well into the 19th century, time in the European imagination was still shallow rather than deep. Of course, we all know what changed this. It was primarily historical geology which changed historical conceptions of time. As the geological and the paleontological record became better and better understood, it seemed clearly to show that the Earth was fantastically old, and not only fantastically old, but that it had been inhabited by forms of life that were radically different from any that you see today. Ladies and gentlemen, when the coming of deep time came to the European imagination and to European science, it came cataclysmically. It came very rapidly. By 1855, British geologists had succeeded in mapping out the geological periods of the Earth pretty much as we accept them today. And by 1860 or 1865, Charles Darwin and his geological allies, Charles had changed his mind by then, we're estimating the amount of time that had gone by since the Cambrian period to actually be slightly longer than we estimate it to be today. So deep time, when it comes very quickly. The question of whether the presence of human beings on Earth went back more than 5,000 or 6,000 years remained controversial for about another decade. But by 1870, it was clear that the presence of human beings on Earth, had a history which could be measured in hundreds of thousands of years, the coming of deep time. And ladies and gentlemen, in the light of this fantastic discovery of time, I'm tempted to say that the coming of the theory of evolution could be regarded as nothing more than a sort of scientific footnote to that discovery of time, that it really wasn't so important, that it was sort of inevitable given that enormous discovery of time that took place in the 19th century. But anyway, to sum up, by 1900, the age of the Earth and life on Earth and the age of the solar system, if not the universe itself, had been expanded by four orders of magnitude, in about 90 years. And in the 20th century, another three orders of magnitude would be added, and the age of deep time had begun. So what? I just posed the question, how the discovery of deep time, when it came historically, changed our understanding of ourselves and our place in nature. And there's a stock answer, and I think that stock answer is largely correct. I think the coming of deep time made the place of human beings on Earth and in geohistory seem much smaller and more insignificant than it ever had before. I think it's correct that deep time seemed, in imaginary terms, in the Western imagination, to open up vistas that were so vast and so sublime and so terrifying that human culture and human history seemed dwarfed in comparison. And if that's true, then I just want to throw out a suggestion that the discovery of deep time may then intersect with another story in the history of science, a story which has not yet been written very well or very fully. And this was the story of the scientific debates over anthropogenic climate change in the 20th century, about whether human action is causing climate change or not. As I say, this history really hasn't been written, but when it is written, I think it's going to show that there was widespread scientific skepticism in the 20th century until 1970, maybe a little later, about the idea that human activity could have had a significant effect on climate and climate determinants. And I want to throw out this speculation for our discussion tonight that one source of this skepticism involves supposed lessons learned from deep time, right? Skeptics, I think, ask, how is it possible for something as puny as human culture and human agency to significantly influence the Earth and the environment? They found it difficult to accept that one recent and short-lived species, like Homo sapiens, could conceivably do anything that would disrupt or override those great long-lived cycles of cosmic continuity in geological history and in cosmic history, which live in deep time, right? I speculate that until 1870, and in some cases well past 1870, many scientists, not all of them in the employ of Syncrude and Exxon, thought that claims for anthropogenic climate change flew in the face of the lessons that deep time had taught us about the Earth and the universe and our place in it. The idea was that if you grasp the real immensity and complexity of nature, you know, the smallness of human beings, then the claims for anthropogenic climate change seemed extremely improbable to many scientists, and maybe to a few today. Had occasion in connection with another project a few years ago to read some of the scientific literature opposing climate change. It's very interesting literature, very complex literature, and this theme appears. I don't want to exaggerate. You don't see it in all the attacks on climate change, anthropogenic climate change, but it's there. You see it. If you look closely, you can see it underlying some of the other more technical arguments. And I guess the moral of this, if there is a moral, is that it's possible to learn the wrong lessons from the right evidence. So anyway, I just throw out this idea to ask whether, in fact, I should probably move on. Whether there are other ways in which the discovery of deep time have changed our conceptions about the way we fit into nature and the universe. Are there ways in which it is affecting both science and popular culture today? And so I leave that question hanging. Boy, you really are patient tonight. Got time for one more? The last question about time? All right. I'm going to turn back to my colleagues in Tilley Hall and go back to the professional historians for a moment and ask what they think of time, what professional historians think of time. And the answer, I have to be careful because there's so many of them here and they're going to take me to task. I think the answer is that historians have not much been interested in time per se. I think historians would say that history is not really about time, but it's about change. Right? And they are not the same things. They are not the same things. I think some historians would go further and say that history properly understood is really about the kinds of change that arise from human agency, right? That history is about the change which we make and not just about the change we experience, right? That agency is involved. And if one wanted to push this idea, and I do, of course, I got to fill up time. I would say that maybe there's even a tension between time and history, time and written history, a tension between duration and change, a tension between experience and agency as we try to imagine the past. And having laid that out, put that idea out for your delectation, I want to turn and discuss two contemporary trends in our thinking about time and history and change, which I think are relevant to our conversation about time tonight. And the first one I want to talk about is the growing interest in what some commentators are calling big history. You've heard of big history. Ladies and gentlemen, most of us here know that we're coming off three decades of periods in which postmodernist and writers in the postmodernist vein have urged us against writing grand narratives. Grand narratives are bad, postmodernist writing said, that the truth, if there is such a thing as truth, you know, lives in small stories. But I think now, over the last 15, 20 years, there's clear evidence that historians are turning back to grand narratives, and if not to grand narratives exactly, at least to big stories. They're turning back to world history. And some are going further. Some are beginning to write histories which place the history of human beings on Earth in the context of cosmic evolution and deep time and geohistory. They're writing these big histories, capital B, capital H. And these are histories that begin with a chapter on the Big Bang and conclude with a chapter on the most recent election. You can see it coming, can't you? Which was kind of Big Bang in its own right. Well, ladies and gentlemen, I'm no expert on these big histories. I haven't read a lot of these books, but that won't keep me from venturing a few generalizations about the genre. And the genre is that the generalizations are this. These big histories are accounts in which political and military and social developments are likely to be relatively ignored or portrayed as insignificant. The action of history in big history is driven, I think, by environmental changes and by big demographic changes. And when people come into the story, they come in through large patterns of migration and cultural clashes of a kind that go on over the heads, if you can put it that way, of ordinary people. It's a kind of history that does not insist on human agency. Well, is this important? People say, historians say also, that history, as it's written, is as much about the present as it is about the past. And they also say sometimes that people get the kind of history, eras get the kind of history that they need and they want. And if that's true, if there's anything about that, then I might suggest that today's big history is a kind of history for an age like ours that's struggling with globalization and with cosmopolitanism. It may speak to our feeling of vulnerability before environmental threats and climate change. It may respond in all sorts of complex ways to our anxiety over the ability of human and political agency to cope with these threats. Do you remember the idea that what I mentioned just a moment ago, that there may be a tension between time and history in the way we imagine the past, between duration and agency? And if there's anything in that, then maybe we can say that with the rise of big history today, time is sort of making a bid to engulf history, that this is a sort of counterattack on the part of time. Doesn't make a bit of sense, does it? The cookies will be good. The slide is going to tell you, if you could just see it, that there's a second trend that has come over the horizon in the last 10, 15 years about the way we perceive history and change, which I think is relevant to our conversations on time. And I'd like to talk about it a little now. Over the last couple of decades, historians have begun to grapple with the relationship between history, on the one hand, and collective memory or historical consciousness on the other. And what's the difference? By history, they tend to mean the historical past as professional historians reconstruct it, right? Whereas by historical consciousness, they mean the collective memory of the past as in the way people, that it's perceived by particular groups of people or by ordinary people other than historians per se. Historical consciousness, we're there, good. Historical consciousness reflects the way people draw upon the past, are beginning to draw upon the past to shape how they think about themselves and their group identities today. And I want to look at historical consciousness a little bit more closely. I submit to you, ladies and gentlemen, that today, as never before, history is hot. It's certainly hotter than it was when I was coming along in the 1970s and 1980s, when not too many people cared about it. What are the signs of this? Well, one of the signs is that today, when a hardworking professional historian goes to the archives, to the public archives, they can't get a seat because all these amateur genealogists are elbowing them out of the way. You know, genealogy, popular genealogy, is big these days. It shows itself, popular historical consciousness shows itself in the mass enthusiasm for commemorations and historical reenactments, which are big in Canada, but huge in the United States. In the southern United States, part of the world that I came from years ago, they refight the Civil War every weekend when it doesn't rain. And I understand that it often ends differently in the reenactments. Popular historical consciousness erupts in the occasional museum wars. You've heard about the museum wars in Canada and the United States, which swirl about competing representations of the past. And some skeptics see historical consciousness as the newly fashionable link between shared historical experience and ethnic identity and what has been called the politics of suffering. I'm very afraid to push this button. Ladies and gentlemen, you would think that professional historians would be happy about this surge in popular historical consciousness, but in fact, they are often very leery of it. They agree that academic history and popular historical consciousness are committed to using the past in very different ways and for very different ends. What are these differences? Historians are interested in historical causation to a large degree. What they're looking for is a broad, critical, accurate understanding of the past. And they try to achieve that understanding by distancing themselves from the past and cultivating attitudes of neutrality and sympathy toward the passions of the past. In contrast, most forms of popular historical consciousness today are not really interested in causation, and they don't really have much commitment to neutrality. Individuals and groups turn to a fragmented past in the search of cultural and ethnic identity in the present. Or they seek validation through history of present political agendas. Or they look to the past for entertainment and vicarious thrills and escapism. Has anybody seen that delightful TV series called Rain? No. You're much too sophisticated to watch anything like that. I am not. As the French, but you have to watch it with a satirical eye. As the French theorist Pierre Nora wrote, history is the enemy of memory. History is the enemy of memory. By memory, he means something like popular historical consciousness today. And I suggest that perhaps we could turn Nora around and say that memory is the enemy of history, that memory is the enemy of history. So why has popular historical consciousness reasserted itself so strongly in popular culture since, I think it's about the 1990s, the very early 1990s? There are a few stock answers. Some theorists claim that it is a result of the gradual decline of nationalism and the nation state in the later decades of the 20th century. For a lot of people, these are just no longer compelling sources of emotional identity and faith in the future that they were in the past. People are less inclined to put stock in narratives of liberal progress based on the nation and national self-realization. That's the claim that's made. Do you agree? Hand in hand with this explanation goes the collapse of international socialism in the 1990s. That collapse, it's claimed, led to the erosion of faith in progress, views of faith in progress that were based on redistribution and the class struggle. So what you have is these two great 20th century narratives of social change, liberal nationalism on the one hand and socialism on the other, very different, but also very similar in many ways, in that they both tended to direct popular, they were future-oriented. They tended to direct popular consciousness forward out of the past, out of the present, into the what is to come. And their decline over the last several decades, maybe I should say the last decades of the 20th century in the writings of some theorist, amounted to the quote-unquote, the death of the future, the death of the future. Theorists who write in this vein claim that people have begun to turn to the past as a source of meaning and identity and validation today in a way that they used to turn to the future. And in the phrase of John Torpe, which I like, when the future collapses, the past rushes in. When the future collapses, the past rushes in. Well, how much stock should we put in the claims? I don't know, ladies and gentlemen. They're so sweeping and grandiose that I think they require a certain degree of skepticism. But I think you will agree, would you not, that it's quite easy to explain. Wait for it. That it's quite easy to explain some recent political events we all know about as expressions of this turn to memory and popular historical consciousness. We seem to be living today through a period in which there's a widespread repudiation of globalization and international integration in many quarters. And it's certainly easy to portray these as future-oriented visions of change, which are just swimming against the cultural currents of popular historical consciousness. Those people down south who want to make America a great again appeal to a collective memory of an imagined past, which alone can guide the present and replace the future. And that imagined past seems to be located sometimes around the glorious 1950s, as far as I can tell. I think we ought to be cautious about these easy interpretations, these sweeping generalizations. The politics of nostalgia and the dream of golden age have always been elements in our imagination of history and of social time. There's nothing new about them, for sure. But if there's a pendulum which sort of pulls us between the historical past and the historical future, then I just throw out for your consideration the possibility that today that pendulum is swinging in the direction of a fragmented past. In physics, the arrow of time always points toward the future. In politics and in social consciousness and in popular consciousness, I'm not sure that it does. So with that, let's wind up this smorgasbord of questions about the contemporary relationship between time and history and turn to your reactions and discussions. Three questions about history and an attempt about time and an attempt at sort of feeble answers to them is more than enough, especially when, as Tolstoy would say, nobody has asked any in the first place. So ladies and gentlemen, thank you. Thank you for your attention. Yeah.
Thank you very much, Stephen. Stephen, you already alluded to the format of this session, and which reminded me of the first lapses. I forgot to introduce the format of the session. We have first a speech, but this whole thing is called conversations. So when we, and the we is the second lapses, I forgot to introduce the committee of the people organizing these conversations. It's myself, it's Vikar, Hussein from the math department, and Jennifer Andrews from the English department. We got together and thought about how can we do that and how do we want to do that. We didn't just want to do presentations. We also wanted the presenters to reflect on why they speak about what they're speaking. I mean, I pitched that to Stephen. He said, "Nah, I'm not good for that. I'm not really the reflective person. Why didn't you talk to Alan Rose, who's our next speaker in a couple of weeks down the road?" And we said, "Yes, that's a very good idea," but we still invited him. And so I'd like to ask you a couple of questions in that regard, starting the conversations, and then the third part, of course, is questions from the audience. So maybe. Starting with the not so obvious, but apparently you are passionate about the history of clocks.
Oh, yeah.
That's obvious. But why? What made you think about the history of clocks, the significance of clocks in the context of time?
because I love the idea that something so simple and so beautiful and so elegant as that little mechanical device could have such sweeping impact on history. I think all of us, you know, somehow are attracted to the idea that there are causes, small causes that produce huge effects. And I think that was a small cause that produced a huge effect. I just find it fascinating as an historical episode.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Is that what got you started in your interest of history, or is that something that you became more aware of a little later, the significance of that?
Well, I was a historian of science, of course, and when you do the history of science, somehow the story of scientific thought coming to terms with time and with history and with change in the universe is something you just don't escape. So time comes with the turf, I would say.
Right. Okay. The second question is, when we deal with history, and you know, part of my academic background is history, my PhD is in church history, we deal with something backwards, some people say. We still deal with, you mentioned historical change, but we focus on something that happened in the past, even if it is relevant to the present. You gave some examples like the historical reenactment, heritage, escapism. So how do you think looking backward can help us move forward in time?
I'm not sure how to answer that, but I'd sort of counter it in a way. Sometimes looking... Can I be really saying this as a professional historian? Sometimes looking back can keep you from looking forward. Mm-hmm. It depends on what you look to the past for, what you look backward for. And as I was just sort of trying to hint in that last, sometimes if you look backward for the wrong things, you read the wrong lessons, you find the wrong lessons. So,
So if you're not looking for the, how would you do it right?
By letting the lessons of the past teach you humility and neutrality and sympathy for people in all walks of life, in all situations, and knowing that somehow, you know, the quandaries of those moral dilemmas and dilemmas that you meet in history are those that you're going to meet in the present and meet in the future, mm-hmm. right? That's the only lesson that you can draw.
And the final question from my side is, you talked about you know, some of the interesting sort of big questions, death of the future. There are some other questions that haunt me recently, and the question about not just fragmented history, but you know, the dissolution of time. Some people say that the present is under attack. And what they mean by that is that some of us, and you alluded to that, are trying to reinstate a glorious past that probably never happened. Mm-hmm. Others try to bring the future into the present or let the present shape the future. I'm just reminding people of algorithms that companies like Amazon use by trying to give us products that we don't even know that we will need in the future. Right. So it's kind of a play or a statement where people say, you know, past, present, future, that's no longer the reality. Time is not flowing from the past to the future. Mm. It's kind of disintegrated. Mm. It's happening here, there, and everywhere. What do you think about that?
That's interesting. That's interesting. I'd need to think about it a little bit. The blurring of the blurring of the present is a kind of short-term blurring. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's a what is this product that Amazon is going to invent that I'm going to buy? You know, it's one that I'm going to buy next week, next month, next year. It's a kind of short-term blurring, as opposed to sort of long-term blurring. I'm just trying to think about what the significance of that is. I think it probably leaves the present and the past and the future untouched, but changes the present. Maybe it's a kind of hyper-presentism. Mm-hmm. I can't do better than that.
Well, let's leave it at that. We want to leave something to the next presentation a couple of weeks down the road, which is about deep time and deep thought, I think. So we will keep thinking deeply about those things. Questions from the audience.
All right. So my question is about deep time. Now, you spoke about deep time, this concept, as being something that's relatively modern in being studied. So what occurred to me, and I don't know if this is, well, I'll just give you my thought. The societies that didn't have clocks, let's say people like the Polynesians, or people like, I'm trying to think of other examples, but they had a sense of myth, of history, and this had to do with all that they experienced in life. But I'm wondering if that wasn't also a way of thinking about deep time, not so much in hundreds of thousands of years, but in the sense of being a history that was their the context for their lives. So I guess my question is, isn't that also a concept of deep time in the life of humanity?
Yeah, sure. It's a concept of deep time. And there are two questions and two comments there. And one, I think, refers to a concept of time which maybe is different from ours, in which time is still in contact with biological and organic sequences of our lives in a way that clock time to some extent would replace in European civilization. And the other, yes, there are many societies which have deep times and the imagination of deep times, infinitely expansion of deep times. The only thing that I would raise about that is whether they are concepts of time in which the time is continuous with our own time and which can be seen as an extrapolation and preparation for our own time. And I'd have to think about that as to whether they meet those criteria. I mean, deep time, the deep time of biology and geology in the 19th century was in a sense an extension into the past of our present time. With the continuity. I'm not sure that mythological time sort of meets those same standards, and in that case, they're sort of different imaginary conceptions of time. Do you know what I mean?
Yes.
Yeah.
I'm not sure
okay.
What you mean, but
that's
okay.
Yeah,
okay. This is not a pat question, Steve. I was struck by the fact that you, as a sailor, said nothing about time and tide, wait for no man, or a person, I guess. And it occurred to me that if mechanistic time is invented, if that's the right term, just bear me out, about 1300, that's a fundamentally different form of time because it tends to be, well, we organized around 24 hours, where previous concepts of time would have been lunar. Yeah. They would have changed, they would have varied from season to season, from leap year to leap year. And I guess the question I want to ask you is, in thinking about time as a kind of abstract concept, before 1300, and I don't mean this to be ridiculous, would you have said time and tide wait for no one, or would you simply have said tide waits for no one? And whether you have any thoughts about that time as a kind of independent, abstract concept free from natural processes?
Well, tide is certainly one of those deeply intrinsic biological environmental conceptions by which people measure time and continue to measure time today. And it certainly didn't disappear in 1300. I don't mean to suggest that it did. But could I answer a question that you didn't ask?
Sure.
Because Tolstoy says it's all right. In the history of astronomy, it's very interesting to look at the history of clocks and the timing of astronomical events. And by and large, clocks are regulated. Mechanical clocks are regulated ultimately at the limits of precision, but by astronomical observations until about 1860 or 1870. And about that point, mechanical clocks become so perfect, so highly refined, that they're actually more accurate than the astronomical observations which can be made. And at that point, at least in elite conceptions of time associated with science, I think clock time has replaced the tides, replace the motion of the heavens. But anyway.
Thank you, Steve, for an extremely stimulating talk. And I'm going to ask a question, and I'm not sure if I'm asking a question about time,
or if I'm asking a question about history. Because one of the things you didn't talk about is the relationship between time and imperialism. Because one of the conceits of people of European descent is that they can control time. Mm-hmm. And that there are other people in the world who either can't control time well, despotic people in despotic cultures in which there's this kind of slow movement into the future, or many indigenous peoples who are outside of time, and or outside of history. And so there's a kind of blurring there. Mm-hmm. And it seems to me that on the one hand, going to your question of global warming, on the one hand, there are people who believe they can control the future. They believe they can control time at the same time that they believe that they're not doing anything to nature. So there's a way in which time becomes outside of nature itself, mm-hmm. and it becomes something that is very subject to human control, but only some kinds of humans, not humans who come with too much melanin in their skin or, you know, who come with the wrong biological anatomy. Mm-hmm. So there's a big, it seems to me that there is a huge question about time and history, and time as it becomes prophetic of the future more than it becomes honest to the past.
Mm-hmm. Two important comments that I'll just comment on the first, and that is the notion of the imperialistic proto-Western sense of superiority about time, not so much about time, but about the history of other cultures, is that other cultures have no history. And you meet it in the writers whom you think would be much more sympathetic, meet it in Marx and Engels, you know, history as we know it is the history of Europe. And other cultures, it's not just that other cultures have a different history or an insignificant history, they don't have a history because they don't have agency, they don't do anything. And the only thing I would say about that is that by that point, history has become associated with the liberal / socialist narrative of progress, right? This is a particular kind of history that Europeans have that others don't have. It's a history that's leading into a glorious future, right? But I like the notion that somehow time is sort of independent of human control when we want it to be, when we want to wash our hands of what we're doing to it, right? And I don't quite know where to go with that, but I think that's a very interesting idea. But it is, in a sense, this idea that history is something that goes on, that we have no responsibility for, I think is rooted to that conception of Newtonian mathematical time as equitably flowing duration when we want it to be. I think it's rooted to the concept of deep time, that somehow, you know, we can reassure ourselves that the time is beyond us and bigger than we are. So it isn't just that it makes us small, it makes us not responsible.
Anymore.
Yeah.
I think you had your... So I guess my question comes from another grand historical narrative, which you didn't really talk about. Maybe it isn't so grand, it's anarchism. And so anarchists, for a lot of anarchists anyway, thought that tyranny, as we are increasingly experiencing mm-hmm. in the world, has come along with the pervasiveness of mechanical time, and as that became more and more part of culture, the kinds of tyranny that we were subject to has become that much more brutal and that much more unseeing. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And the converse of that is that if we're ever going to sort of get rid of that kind of tyranny, we have to go back to those organic biological mm-hmm. rhythms of time and kind of end the tyranny of mechanical time. I'm just wondering if you could say anything about that.
I can't comment it because I don't know anything about it, but it's a fascinating notion. And certainly the idea of time as being an instrument of worker control and labor control, you know, runs through, I don't know about the literature of anarchism, but runs through the literature of socialism and runs through modern historical accounts of the experiences of the working classes in the 18th and 19th centuries. Yeah, time is an instrument of oppression. Clock time is an instrument of oppression.
Right. Steve, I'd like to go back to the concept of deep time again. And you said, if I understood you correctly, that sort of by the late 19th century, the people who are studying the past and the deep past have a pretty good grasp on how deep that past is. Yeah. And they've changed it from a few thousand years to hundreds of thousands, if not millions of years. But I'm trying to remember, and I can't put a date on it in spite of our focus on time here. At some point, we developed the concept of atomic time based on decay of isotopes. Yeah. And I can't remember quite who comes up with that. But we're now able to more precisely date the deep past using radio decay. Right. And I'm just wondering, does that change anything very much, or does it simply make our concept of the deep past just a little more precise than it was in the 1870s?
Makes it deeper. And I'll just tell one quick story about that. One of the great stories in the history of science at the end of the 19th century is the conflict between the geologist who insists that the age of the Earth is very old and the physicist who deny that it is. And the physicists are basing their estimates, many people know the story, on the rate at which the Earth seems to be losing heat. And those calculations are wrong, turn out to be wrong in the 20th century because they do not take into account the radioactivity of the rocks. So it's very interesting. For 40 years, you have this great split between geologist and physicist, and it's a bit of a scandal in the late 19th century. But both sides, to some extent, have a vested interest in not pushing it too hard. But it turns out that the geologists were right for the reasons that you say.
Steve, just to clarify that, it was radioactive decay that produces heat, and therefore Kelvin didn't have that as part of his equation.
Right. Yeah. And we should probably add that Kelvin may have reached the conclusion that he did in part because he wanted the Darwinians to be wrong.
I saw several
the cultural as well as scientific issues involved, as there always are.
Thanks for a very nice talk. I have a question concerning another notion of time. You might call it shallow time, which is connected to the clock and connected to the financial system. And the equation is time is money. Do you have any comments on that?
Wow. Well, two things come to mind, and the first is that the preciousness of time in the Puritan conception of time and our obligation to work constantly was associated. I mean, some people say it's an old hackneyed historical interpretation that somehow Reformation, puritanical conceptions of time and the need to use it were connected with profitability, that work and success and time and the proper use of time and exploitation of time all go together as a new, dare we say, capitalist cultural ideal of that period. And I'd come back and say that time is money also ties into the notion in the 19th century of time as something that you use for labor exploitation, right? And that too is time. Time as money, time as other people's work and lives.
Right. Thank you for a very interesting talk. I have a question about what are your thoughts about the mechanical clock as an automaton? And you mentioned you talked about the death of the future. Do you think that we're using the same ideas that we came up to construct the mechanical flow of time to get to construct a mind? So from clockwork, are we sort of led to neural network?
Well, yes. Yeah. I think I think basically, you know, what's happened in the history of science, you want huge sweeping generalizations. Here's one. I think what's happened in the history of science and is that human beings have invented ever new forms of machines, ever new forms of machines. In the 17th century, a machine is a mechanical machine and a hydraulic machine. In the 19th century, it becomes a chemical machine. In the early 20th century, it becomes an electrical machine. And in the late 20th century, it becomes a kind of information machine, right? And I think what we're seeing is each of these machines giving rise to new interpretations of human beings and human nature. But first comes the machine, and then we reinterpret ourselves in terms of those machines. And I think the idea of neural networks and neural network-based intelligence, artificial intelligence, is the latest step in a pattern that's been unfolding since the 17th century. How you like that for a generalization?
Well, thank you, Steve, for a very interesting talk. I have two comments. One directly connected to the previous question. Maybe it's a quantum machine, quantum mechanics as opposed to classical mechanics, or a quantum clock as opposed to a classical clock. I have a comment. Well, the talk that you have presented assumes a linear time. Mm-hmm. And there are all sorts of other concepts that you can have cyclical time, you could have all sorts of other non-linear framework in which you can build a history or whatever changes in history. And then I'll make a comment, and I would like you to think about an analog. In physics, when we talk about time, historically it was introduced, I mean, if there is no heat flow, no heat exchange, it's very hard to define time. What would be the analog of a heat flow in what you have presented to us in terms of history as a past, a present, and a future?
Wow. Wow. I'm tempted to give an answer that somehow involves money, that somehow involves concepts of the way we all, channeling my inner Marxist here, the notion, the way we organize our lives, the way we organize our production, the way we base our material lives, somehow it seems to me that that's somehow tied up with time and gives us a direction of time in social ways, right? And that's pretty vague, but it's a hard question. And I know absolutely nothing about quantum time or quantum clocks, but I will say that my grand narrative about technologies bringing new conceptions of human nature in their wake, dragging new conceptions of human nature in their wake, has great difficulty with quantum physics, with 20th century physics. I don't quite know how to fit that into the model. Maybe you can tell me sometimes, right?
Talk about different concepts of time, and you have introduced quite a number of different ones. And but as a historian of science, you begin with the mechanical clock, which has determined much of Western history. And then you also spoke about postmodernism debunking the notion of meta-narratives, but then introducing the notion of deep time and even big history. I'm wondering how some other concepts of time would fit into a Western notion, things like that which is beyond time, cyclical time, which comes out of many civilizations past and still present, eternal time, reincarnated time. How do these concepts of time fit into a Western notion of time, especially the way that you have laid it out? from past and then present, and that a look at, if history is a story of the past to inform the future, what about these other concepts of time? How do they fit into your understanding?
I phrased the talk tonight in terms of, you know, my experience wrestling with the history of science and the time which has dominated, you know, European scientific concepts has been a linear concept of time, a continuous continuity of time in the Newtonian tradition, and the fact that now in the 20th century it may be out there in little chunks rather than continuous doesn't really change that fundamentally. But yes, there are other conceptions of time that they have not dominated, I think, the European imagination in the way that they perhaps dominated other the imaginations of other cultures. And I just make two comments about it, these other times are different. Not cyclic time is important, and then in other cultures you meet the idea of times which are somehow disconnected from the linear time in which the world unfolds, in which our lives unfold. And the only comment I can make is that certainly we need to record the fact that, as I understand the Christian imagination of time, that time is a created thing, right? And that God exists outside, you can comment on this better than I, exists outside time, and that there will be, dare I say, a time when there was no time, and a future when there will be no time. And in a sense, these are durations or imaginations that take place outside of this linear flow of time. So it isn't that the Western scientific imagination has been free of these other concepts, but they've been discontinuous with linear time, linear Newtonian time. Does that make any sense at all? Ross? Yeah. Oh, sorry.
Go back to the idea mentioned just two speakers ago, and that's linear versus nonlinear time. I would say that linear time is this clock, mechanical time you're talking about, but nonlinear time is really human time. And we all know that for each of us, time does not flow like a clock. Sometimes time goes very slowly. Sometimes time moves very quickly. And I think our society is becoming more and more tied to the clock time. And I think it's a kind of tyranny that's creating more and more tension as we have to adhere more closely to this artificial thing called clock time. Mm-hmm. So what are your thoughts on that?
I'll just let the remark stand and say that I agree with it. But I'd add the comment to it that historical time, history in a way, as we imagine it and write it, is sort of like personal time in that way. Historical time, the time of historians doesn't unfold at a constant rate. And historians play fast and loose with centuries and talk about the, you know, the long 14th century and the short 20th century and so forth. In a way, historical time is like personal time in the sense that it's not equitably flowing duration. And that may be another one of the sources of tension between time and history, as it is between clock time and personal lived experience.
Are you up to? Do you have time for one more question?
I have time for one more question.
Steve, as a literary person, I'm going to ask you about a question that pertains to the rise of narrative time as opposed to mechanical time. So during the period in which you're talking about in Europe, this ever-increasing interest and influence of mechanical time, at the same time there's what literary scholars call the rise of the novel. And the novel, obviously, is a telling of time that is very much slowed down, speeded up, rearranged, and reorganized. Mm-hmm. I thought at one point about Joseph Conrad's novel, The Hard Darkness, which is, in a short novel, a grand narrative of the imperial conquest of the Congo, except that it's just a little story being told by this guy Marlowe on a ship while he's waiting for the tides to turn.
Yeah. I'm standing here wishing that I could find some way to relate the sort of pliancy of narrative time to historical practice as well. And I think if I worked at it, I probably could. That in a sense, that same sense of time is flowing in different directions and understood in different from different perspectives by different actors may sort of reproduce itself in historical writings. I've got to think about that. I'll just stop.
Well, thank you, Ross. Fortunately, time is not over, but I think we have to end it at some point. Thank you very much, Stephen, for coming and for making yourself available for the conversation as well. Thank you very much for coming. And just a reminder, there is a third event with Professor Alan Rose from the Faculty of Education talking about deep time, deep thought on, and I'm embarrassed to say, what March is it? Is it March 13th? Tuesday? Do you remember?
No.
None of us do. It's Tuesday after, I think it's Tuesday after the March break. I think it is. There will be posters, there will be announcements again, but keep that in mind. See how we deal with time, kind of fluid. Thank you.